down alone while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God disclosed. Tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling. Tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry,
would you join me as we pray together? Our Father, there are no surprises to you, but that does not secure us from experiencing them. And we find that your grace is ever sufficient for us as we move along in this journey with you. You're so good, Lord. My vocabulary is totally inadequate of speaking of your sufficiency and of your grace in its totality. We need you today. We need you, Father, to give us the words to say, and we need you, Father, to give us the strength upon which to lean. And we need your wisdom to help us to know the next step of each of us as we move through this journey of life. We thank you for Harry. For his love for you, and for his love for the church, and for his love for people. And so we pray that you will bless Bill and I as we share today, and those who shall sing and play, that, Lord, it will be a moment of inspiration to us, and for Deb and Paul and the family, how we love them and how we pray for them. And I know with the faith that's there, Lord, that they'll triumph through this experience and move forward. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall never want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the very presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. How many times I've read that, I have no idea. But every time I read it, it is as fresh as it was the first time I read it. It never loses its power and its impact in helping us in a time like this. The story is told by each of us, for each of us. In other words, we all tell our own story. We're telling it today, and we'll be telling it tomorrow. And there's not anything that Bill and I can add to the life of Harry that Harry didn't already put in it. We cannot add one inch, nor would we ever dare to take away an inch. It's not ours to do. He told his story. Dale and Harry have served in the ministry of this church with willingness and gratitude without error and without slothfulness. They were here when I came as pastor, and I pastored them almost 25 years. I'm not a yard man, but I was working in our yard here. And when I became pastor of Sweat Memorial, Harry came up to me one day and he said, "Wouldn't you like to have some help with that yard?" And I said, "Those are the words of an angel." Not that I'm calling you an angel, I'm just telling you that what you said is the words of an angel. Well, that was in the house we lived in, the home we lived in before we are now. That's where he started. He worked in our yard for Vera and I for 29 years. Well, some of our neighbors got to know him because he was there at least twice a week, just because he wanted to be there. And after one of our neighbors met him, our neighbor said to me, and he did a marvelous job, and they were talking about it all the time. This neighbor came up to me and said, "I need to talk to Harry." He already knew him well enough, it was Harry. And I said, "What do you need to talk to Harry about?" He said, "Well, I drove by your house the other day, and I found that Harry had left one blade of grass higher than all the other." I said, "Well, that's a pretty neat way of telling me how jealous you are." The last time I spoke to Harry was last Friday. He knocked on our door over the patio, and I went, and there stood Harry. He said, "Brother Freddie, I need to share with you that for the next 2 weeks I'm going to be gone. I'm going to go camping, and then I'm going on a cruise." But he might have gotten it backwards. I'm not sure which was which. I think the first week was the camping. And he said, "I just want to check with you and make sure that it's all right with you." I said, "Absolutely, it's all right with me." I said, "Just don't leave any of this equipment here. Because if something needs to be done, my wife may say, go out there and get Harry's stuff and get that done. So if you're going to be gone, you take it." And we laughed a little about that. And Harry went on his way. I've received a lot of phone calls in my ministry. But the phone call that I got Monday morning set me back. And I sat there after that phone call and shared with my wife what had happened. And I said, "Harry has taught us all something that we need to be reminded of. One, you don't know when you're going to die. Now, you may think you've got that fact figured out in your life, but I'm going to tell you, you might as well take all of that tabulation and throw it out the window. Because it's not your tabulation that's going to settle the issue anyway, it's God's. And if you think Harry had any intent of meeting the Lord Monday morning, that was not his intent. His intent was to do exactly what he always did and what the group always did, meet there, settle down, and camp, and come back, and then take the cruise. Didn't happen that way. So your friend and my friend has said to all of us today, you never know when you're going. So be ready." Now, Harry's told you that, and he's told me that. You say, "Now, Brother Freddie, that's a little scary." Well, maybe you need to be scared a little. Because perhaps you haven't thought about that lately like you should have. It is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment, so we know that's coming. The second thing we learned is not only that you can die at any minute, the Lord can call you home, but secondly, we don't know how we're going to die. We don't choose that. But we know that Harry met the Lord with Deb following along behind in her car. He met the Lord doing something that he was enjoyed doing. But perhaps we could all say to today, "I don't like the way it happened." Well, that's not an item of discussion either. No more than you and I have the selection of how we go. But I can tell you this, he's better off than you and I are today. He's in a better place today than where you and I are today. And I'm happy for him from that standpoint, for sure. There are two words that are separated by one letter. Here and there. And the letter that keeps those two words from being the same is the word T. Just between those two words is one letter, T. Now, some write the letter T with the horizontal line at the top. And then others cross it through the line. But it reminds me of the cross. Here, there. And the difference between those two words of destiny is the cross. And we don't get from here to there by bypassing the cross. Not by gazing upon it, not by coming close to it, but to experiencing the work of the cross that it does in our life through the death of Jesus Christ. There's the here, which is the now. We call it the journey. The present that is affording us to travel various roads of ministry. Here, where questions arise that we have to deal with, as we have this one today, here. John 16:23 says, and Deb and I talked about it yesterday, that there will come a day when you get to heaven that there are going to be questions you're not going to be bothered about. There may be questions you're asking now because you're trying to interpret it with the naked eye. And it may be troubling you. But when you step into glory and see what the Lord has prepared for his people, these questions that we're dealing with today would not even be thought of anymore. Because the beauty of his work of that place will take care of it. Here, it's where the crossroads of life challenge our negotiating, where the dealings with birth and death. No wonder John Bunyan, when he wrote Pilgrim's Progress, he named the Christian pilgrim, simply because that's what it is, a pilgrim. Here, we're standing on the seashore, and we're looking out yonder where the sea, way out in the distance, falls into the sky, it seems. And we ask, I'm limited in what I can see, and so you are. Here, where our lives are related to one another. Sometimes it's good and sometimes it's challenging in the home, in the church, or in the community, wherever it may be. We have to admit we don't always get along as well as we should with one another. And yet the Lord has made arrangements for that in restitution. But in the midst of here, this journey, hear what Paul says. For we know that in this journey, for we know, surely we know, surely we've learned that all things, ever how sweet they may be, or ever how dark they may, or bitter they may be, ever how delightful they may be, or disgusting they may be, we surely know and understand that all of these things work together for good to them who love God and who are called according to his purpose. In our questions and in our doubts and frustrations, it is at the end of that verse that we want to start, where we focus upon that we love him with an unerring love, regardless of the challenge, regardless of what we've seen, regardless of what we experience. We as the children of God shall not let any of that diminish our love for him. And then Paul says, if we'll stay called according to that which he wants to purpose in our life, then he has the ability to make it all a spiritual purpose in our life. You may say, well, it's going to take God to do it. Well, surely it's going to take God to do it. We wouldn't have gotten this far had it not been for him anyway. And Paul said that I have fought a good fight. I have finished the course. I've kept the faith here. Here is to receive what thou givest. Here is to lack what thou withholdest. Here is to surrender what thou claimest, to suffer what thou ordainest, to do what thou commandest, and to wait until you sayest, go. For in all of it, God is working out a ministry and a testimony in all of our lives. Then thou sayest, go there. There, by the way of the cross. How many times we've sung that hymn? We don't even need a hymnal to sing it. By the way of the cross, we get to there. No other way but through the cross. And it is the there where we find God's house, where we encounter the many mansions, where we see that prepared place, where we experience the receiving of what God will give us, where we will have the joy of ever abiding in his presence, and where there, we're told there is no tears and there is no sickness. Peter Marshall was a Presbyterian preacher. He was chaplain of the Senate, and I've read some of his books, but he said something that is needful perhaps for me to share with you today. Those we love are with the Lord, and the Lord is with us. So we can't be, Deb, far apart. Think of there. One day, stepping on shore and finding it heaven. On taking hold of a hand and finding it to be God's. Of breathing new air and finding it to be celestial air. of feeling invigorated and finding it to be immortality, of passing from storm and tempest to an unbroken calm, of waking up and finding it home. He's home. Harry's home. Never crank up another lawnmower. Never hold another shovel. But he's left with you and me a tremendous word of encouragement about his life. God bless.
Deb, when I walked in here, I thought of something my mother said when my father passed. When I see this crowd that is gathered here for y'all, she said to me, she said, I knew your dad was a good man, but I didn't know everybody else knew it too. Amen. Y'all knew Harry was all right, but everybody else knew it too, let me tell you. Everybody else knew that Harry was all right. One of the things that I do when we kind of feel like the situation lends itself to that, and this is one of those where Harry is so extremely well known, so extremely well loved, and that is I will ask a family if they wish to share in the comments of the service, you know, what can I say for you? So we sat down yesterday afternoon, Deb and I and some other friends and folks there, and it pretty well puts you kind of on the spot for a moment, but then most families, they pretty well, they get with it. And I think I left there at midnight. What time was it, Deb, when I left there, you know? Not really, but I asked her, and there were several there. I said, what can I say for you? And it began to pour out. And one of the neat things is always in these discussions, when people share something, they'll stop and say, now don't say that tomorrow. Don't say that tomorrow. So I think I got it, okay, Deb? I think I got it. I'm not going to say those things. But so many beautiful things in the celebration of Harry's life that I can share with you on their behalf. There was a phrase that my wife loved so much, and it hung in our home in several rooms. And it said, life is not to be measured by the number of breaths we take, but the number of moments that take our breath away. I know that you will agree with me. Harry Winder lived a breathtaking life and had many, many moments that took his breath away. Several years ago, in one of Charles Allen's books, I read a portion that said, for us to live life to its fullest, to have a breathtaking life, that these elements are needed. And I have organized your stories with these elements. And it's a tribute to Harry, but I pray that it is, as Dr. Smith has reminded us of the brevity and uncertainty of life, that if any of these are missing in your life, I pray that you would resolve, I need those things in my life. And so I began that to live a breathtaking life, it's necessary to have a life full of love. Harry was born January the 15th, 1950. I knew when we give our ages, mine always registered a year ahead of him. But I was born November the 1st, 1949, so he barely got me by 2.5 months, you know. But Harry was born January the 15th, 1950, here in Waycross. And I've gotten to where, in this point in my life, I always mention a person's parents because both of mine are gone. Wonderful, lovely parents, and one day I want somebody to remember them. But born to Richard Leroy Winder and Peggy June Douglas Winder. He was blessed in that birth family with sister Cindy and with Tom. Now, Tom's the twin, right? I keep getting them confused. There's Tom. Oh, I should have known, brother. There's Tom, the twin, and then Joe, the youngest, and then Rick, who has preceded them. And as the family would say through the years, that these three boys, the older ones, were Tom, Dick, and Harry. And he loved to mention that. He loved to. Harry graduated from Waycross High School in 1970, and that poised him to begin to move out into life and to start his career and to start his family. And it was in that year that he and Debbie met, on December the 15th, 1970. Debbie was out with a girlfriend, and that friend was getting ready to go visit her boyfriend, and she invited Deb to go. I always like to know how people met. She invited Deb to go, and Deb went. And she noticed when they went inside, as they pulled up, that there was a big green car in the driveway. And when they went in, Harry was there. The first time she'd ever laid eyes on Harry. And she said he looked like a movie star. And I can see it. He kept that class every day of his life. She said he was so tall, he was so lanky, and he had that smile. And he looked just like an actor or a movie star. And we kept trying to name one, and we're going to name one day, you know. And then she said that she and her friend were leaving, that she walked by that green car. She now knew who it belonged to. And she tapped it as she went along and said to her friend, I'm going to marry him. And then she learned later that that green car, and young people will have to ask your parents about this, it was an Edsel. He was driving a green Edsel. She said, I'll marry him. And then she said that she chased him until he caught her. You got to think about that. She chased him until he called her, and they were married on July the 22nd, 1973. And I jotted, and that marriage way outlasted that Edsel, let me tell you. It way outlasted that Edsel. Our life must be full of love, and she shared that he spoiled her. He spoiled her and said that every morning he woke up cheerful, hopped out of bed, and was ready to go. He was one of those that when he got up in the morning, it was, "Good morning, Lord." Deb said she was not that way. So yours must have been, "Good Lord, it's morning." Harry would bring her a cup of coffee, hand her the remote to the television, had a blanket for her, and if it was cold, he would turn the heat up. Guys, did y'all hear this? Okay. And she said if she was sick, he was her nurse, and a good one, and a good one. I don't know today if she has that necklace on, but in 1972, just before they married, he gave her a promise ring. And she held it out to me last night and said he kept his promise. She has it. And his wedding band. He kept his promise. They were blessed, and I want to move very tenderly here, even though I'm amazed that it's just been a week ago that Deb shared this part of their life here in our office. She's a regular here, and this was before all of this happened this week. But they were blessed to start their family, and it was a rough start with, I'm assuming, the first two conceptions, Richie and Jamie, and you've listed them in the article. They passed as infants. And I know how that feels. My wife was born extremely premature. I think she only weighed 2.5 pounds. And she never was really, really strong in life, and we struggled to get the two girls that we have. Then blessed with Paul. My first time to meet him this week, and I have told him he is an exceptional young man. His wife, Landy, beside him, and grandchildren, Grayson and Bella. Grayson and Bella, the grandchildren. Blessed with the love of family. I had an old associate when I was pastoring in Richmond, Virginia, that would say at services like this, to live in the hearts of those we love is to live forever. A breathtaking life is full of love. And how grateful and how wonderful. A lot of love in this family. And Harry lives not only in heaven with our Lord and many who've gone on, but he will live in our hearts forever. That article, and the author was Richard Cabot, who was chief of surgeon at Boston General Hospital. And he said, for life to be lived to its fullest, and I find this so interesting because one of the first things out of Deb's mouth when we began to share yesterday afternoon was Harry's work ethic. And to live a full life, we need work. And that's something that's been lost by a lot of people in our society. Work. Very faithful there at the hospital for 22 years. And then beginning, as Dr. Smith has mentioned so wonderfully, the lawn care service. And truly, the first words out of Deb's mouth yesterday when I said, now what do you want to tell me about Harry? And she said, he was unique. And that means one of a kind. He was unique. And then she said, he was hard working. And dedicated and busy all the time. Busy all the time. He served in our church here in many wonderful capacities, and he went about it with great dedication and diligence. And whenever his assignment that day involved being around the facility, he never stopped moving. And it was just a week or so ago that as I was watching him move around the church and making sure everything was fine, it dawned on me who he reminded me of. Tall, slim, long-legged, Woody in Toy Story. That was our Harry. I'm telling you, he could get from one place to the other in this church. And she said that he was always good to his clients, to his lawn service clients. He would give them gifts, and at Christmas would give them presents. Harry had a breathtaking life because full of love, and he enjoyed working and accomplishing. There's a third thing. Life must have some joy in it. It must have some fun. Harry Winder had a lot of fun. You know, all work and no play makes us dull, but Harry was a joy and he enjoyed life. He loved to hunt. He loved to fish. He was a scout leader. I just met a gentleman coming in that was in the scouts with him. And he loved camping, as we well know. And I learned something yesterday, even though I have now been here 4 years, and Debbie had a mug there on the table with us that had been monogrammed and personalized, the SMBC Camping Club. Limited to 5 members, 5 families. And it said making memories 1 campsite at a time. I thought about this when I was making notes, and I feel like that this is the place to mention this about this group of 5 couples of the SMBC Camping Club. They are not officially sanctioned by this church. I just wanted you to know that. They are on their own, all right? Y'all are on your own. But oh, what a joy, and thank God they had that. She shared with me that they were up to 16 cruises and would have been cruising this weekend. 16 cruises. He had an incredible sense of humor, loved to imitate Red Skelton. Younger people will have to be told who Red Skelton was. Now, if you got in here to see the video, that boy could dance. And that was part of his Red Skelton routine. He could dance. Harry enjoyed life. Now, before I left there yesterday, I said, now, Deb, overnight, if there's anything you want me to take out, you tell me. And she said, no, there's nothing I want you to take out. Well, it came up that one of Harry's greatest loves was he loved hot dogs. I gave her a chance to take it out, but he loved hot dogs. And they said they could be going somewhere and stop at a convenience store, and they would all be back in the car, and Harry would be the last one out, and they knew where he was. He was fixing one of them hot dogs on those rollers under those lights. And I'm telling you, I know a lot of convenience store owners, but them things have scared me to death. I have never eaten one of those things. And I don't know, and I don't know how it came up, but I think Deb said that somebody asked her, you reckon what Harry's doing in heaven? And she said, he's eating hot dogs. And then these people I were with, they got carried away now. And they said that there's a heavenly hot dog stand up there, and all the hot dogs are kosher, we'll have you to know. Oh, my goodness. Life must have joy. And Harry had joy. But let me tell you what his greatest joy was. He was a giver. He was a giver. They shared they would make trips to North Georgia to a place called Marketplace. Fresh produce coming in all the time. People would pick up a few heads of this or a few of these or a few of that, but they would come out with buggies full because he wanted to give it away. He had people that he wanted to give it away to. When they would go on their beach trips, he would go to Moore's. He would get buckets and buckets of tomatoes so that every cottage had plenty of tomatoes. And they told me that he had the best boiled peanuts anybody ever had. and he loved to give them away. From my heart, I love to share that on Sunday morning, Harry was the first person in my office. He would be the first person to go into my office. And when I would come in, he would be making his rounds here, and he'd tell me all the time, "You're going to like what's on your desk. You're going to like what's on your desk." The chairman of deacons here, Bruce Tyson, mentioned in our meeting last Sunday, because I accused some of them of going in my office and reading my notes, and he said, "When I go in your office, I see that there's always treats on your desk. One Sunday it might be an orange, one Sunday it might be a banana or an apple. Most Sundays it'd be a handful of Jolly Ranchers and diabetic candy bars and baked goods from Deb's kitchen. The last one was a huge blueberry muffin." And he would always say, "It's sugar-free. It's sugar-free." Then there would be times I would come in and he would kind of whisper, "Come here, come here, come here." He'd reach in his pocket and he said, "You're going to really like this." And I started to bring one in, and he'd pull out these little cars that you pick up at convenience stores, these little metal cars in there. I have them all displayed. If you step in my office, there's 8 of them. There better be 8 when y'all leave here today, is all I got to say. And they're classic looking cars. And he'd always say, "You're going to like this." And I do. I do. There are some really classic looking cars in that display there. In that display. Harry lived a breathtaking life, full of love, busy as he could be, a giver, fun, and enjoying. But, as Dr. Smith closed, so I close, the most important thing is faith. Every life must have faith in God. Deb says in Harry's Bible, John 3:16 has been circled multiple times. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Harry did not perish. Harry passed from death unto life. Death unto life. And I want to tell you, there's two phrases that I would send you with. One describes the hope of a Christian, and that is the resurrection. In John 11, when Jesus' dear friend Lazarus passed and Jesus went, Mary and Martha were so upset because they didn't think he got there in a timely fashion. But he told them, "Your brother will live again." He said, "I am the resurrection and the life. And if any dies, he shall live again. He who believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" And she said, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Billy Graham, when he began to sense the coming end of his life here, would tell people, "When you read that I have passed, don't you believe it. I am more alive than ever." I don't know if we can handle Harry when we get to heaven. He is more alive than ever. He really, really is. And if we're Christians, we believe that. He is really, really enjoying himself. And then there is the promise of the reunion in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. And I'll quote the precious lady that told me years ago, when I was leaving Central Baptist Church in the early 80s to go to Atlanta to pass, little Elizabeth Stamps, 92 years old, took my hand and said, "Brother Bill, remember, Christians never see each other for the last time." She was 92, I was 32, and I don't think it sunk in, but it sure has now. because I've not seen Elizabeth for the last time, and I've not seen my parents for the last time, and I've not seen my wife for the last time. And let me just tell you, in my old country way, we ain't seen Harry for the last time. And I thank God for that. Harry lived a breathtaking life.
Go to heaven.
pray a prayer that I pray will be strengthening to all of us. It's a paraphrase of Paul's words in his letter to the Philippians, and that is that I pray for the peace that passes all understanding, the power that overcomes all things, through Christ Jesus our Lord, in whose name we pray.